I think our friend has been watching too much television. Or maybe spending too much time listening to the mainstream media. I think it needs an alternative source of information and inspiration. I've spent a lifetime looking for alternative sources of information and inspiration. And I can tell everyone that what I found is the absolute best source of information. The best source of inspiration is actually what people would refer to as the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is very hip, actually. It knows everything. Nothing bothers it. It knows everything. Total awareness, pure awareness. So you don't become unhip by listening to the Holy Spirit. But what happens is you get clued into what's really important. And that is really actually amazing. And then you realize, oh my gosh, this world is so controlled. The media is so controlled. The planet is so controlled. You're not going to get the scoop there. The Holy Spirit actually has the scoop for us. It has it. And it gave me the scoop today. I got a scoop today. And just been processing it. And it's just like an incredible turnaround. That's because all I did was I said, Holy Spirit, give me the words I need to speak today. Give me the idea I need to focus on today. Tell me what's important in my life today. And then after a while, working with this, trying hard to work with this, something emerged and I said, wow. Game changer. And that simple idea was, I have no choice but to accept the gifts of God. I have no choice but to accept God's gift of holiness. I have no choice but to accept God's gift of holiness. What God gives me is mine. I have no separate will to reject it. I have no separate will to reject it. I have no choice but to accept God's gift of holiness. I have no will, separate will to reject it. What God gives me is mine. And the whole notion of having no choice, I found it to, rather than be a scary, terrible thing, I found it to be tremendously positive. It's like, yeah, that's right. That's what I wanted to hear. Now you're talking. That's real spiritual talk. When you get to the level of realizing you have no choice, then you know that you're seeing it the way that it is. You're ripe. The fruit is ripe. The fruit is ripe. Very rarely will you see any or hear anyone saying, hey, I don't have any choice. Truly don't have any choice. When God gives us a gift, we have no will to reject it. We have no will to reject it. It's ours. Eternally. We cannot say, well, God, I don't think I want that gift. No. What God wills for us is what we have. And God has willed for us that the vision of holiness, the vision of oneness, the vision of holy oneness is ours. It is our gift. It's already been given to us. Everyone has it. They're just in denial of it. They're just disassociating from it. They're just saying they're too busy trying to learn to love and appreciate and value death. So they have no time for it. But when you have no time for the end of time, what happens to you? You remain in time, don't you? So all I'm saying is have time to entertain the end of time. Take time to entertain the end of time. Take time for the end of time. This is, where are you going to get that on the mainstream media? You're going to tune in tonight and they say, you know what? I'd just like to end this broadcast to remind you to take time for the end of time. And know that you have no choice but to accept God's gift of holiness for you. You have no separate will. So that's it, and good night. Oh, okay. And by the way, as you're taking time for the end of time, you don't need to watch any more news. Yeah. So, a lifetime search for the best source of truth, information, inspiration. Holy Spirit has it. Holy Spirit is the one. It's a gift of God. The Holy Spirit is the gift of God, the gift of holiness to us, the blessing of holiness upon all time. The blessing rests upon all time. So, it's here now. It's not subject to time. That which blesses time is not subject to time. It's a very important consideration here. And the problem is when you watch too much television, you're like this. I don't think I'm getting through. I don't think I'm getting through. Television media is bought and paid for. Totally bought and paid for. It's all scripted. It's all purposeful. It's all about what you value. It's all about trying to learn how to love, appreciate, and value death. That's what it's all about. And so, we have someone here who is very much into death, you see, very much into death. But if you listen to the Holy Spirit will tell you a different story, very different story. And the Holy Spirit said, just realize, you have no choice as to whether or not you can accept the gifts of God for you or not. They're given. What is given to me by God is mine already. What is given to me by God is mine already. It doesn't depend on my accepting it or rejecting it or anything. It is mine. So, the gift of holiness has already been given everyone. When we say accept it, it means accept the fact that we have no choice in the matter. This is where we struggle, because we think we have a separate will. There's some separate will, and this separate will is teaching us how to be separate from God. We projected our will and then disassociated with it and believe it's separate from us. And now this separate will seems to be teaching us how to be separate also. And this separate will says all you got to do is learn to love, value, and appreciate death. And what's its real end goal is spiritual suicide for us. And then it says, then you will really have a separate will. Well, of course, if you could, because it's God's will for us as that eternal life. So if we are able to bring about eternal death, you'd have to say we had a separate will, right? Of course, we wouldn't be around to know about that, would we? But who's keeping track of stuff like that anyway? Well, the Holy Spirit is, actually. Yeah, the Holy Spirit's our advocate. It speaks for us. As we're in this comatose state here, the Holy Spirit speaks for us and reminds us, hey, don't spend your time watching television, movies, internet stuff. Be very judicious. Choose carefully what you pay attention to. And by all means, in the morning, and I should start doing it the evening before you go to sleep too, probably. I haven't done that. I'll have to try that. But in the morning, I do try that. I kind of wake up early. Can't sleep well right now. There's too much stress. First blood moon is coming on April 15th of the Tetrad. Four blood moons on four Jewish high holy days. Passover and Tabernacles. Two each. In the middle, total solar eclipse. The indicators that I have, part of what I use, partially some indicators in the world, they're all off the charts. They're all off the charts. Something's coming. Something's coming. Now, I don't know. Is the stock market starting, the crash finally happening? I'm not going to speculate too much on that because it's been delayed. It's been delayed, but we'll see. We'll see what happens in the world. Not too concerned about it because we have no choice but to accept the gifts of God. We have no choice in the matter. So we have the vision of holy oneness. We already have it. God has gave it to us. He's already given it to everyone. But some are so wrapped up again in paying attention to the merchants of death, how to learn to love, value, and appreciate death. They don't realize it. They don't realize it. Realization is just the realizing what we have. That's what realization is. It's not that we've added something to ourselves. God has added something. Vision of holy oneness. We have that. And realization is to realize we've got no choice in the matter. So, since we don't have any separate will to reject it, what do we need time for? We already have the vision of holiness of all time. A holy perspective on time. A holistic perspective on time. What we're doing in this world is dealing with fragmentation. We're slicing and dicing, putting together, cutting apart, reconnecting, connecting this, connecting that, disconnecting this, disconnecting that. Constant dealing with fragment. Everything here is simply fragmentation. Whereas reality is a whole. There's no fragments to reality. And this is all a waste of time. It's all a waste of time. The vision of holiness is the vision of the oneness of all time, as it were. Somehow, we're able to see the holiness of all time, the end of time. And that's the end of time, actually, for us. It's the timeless moment. These are the things that the realized ones talk about, and we have to talk about them because that's the goal. But of course it seems nebulous to us, but we're reeling it in for sure, reeling it in. The exercises that we do are supremely helpful, actually, to reel this in and to feel very comfortable with it. So, I have no choice. That's actually the highest confession there is. I have no choice. That's it. Doesn't get any higher than that. I have no choice. Out of that confession, everything smooths out of that confession. You will find the blocks being removed. If you have no choice, then what use is time? Time is trying to you're working on trying to have a separate will so you can reject what God has given us. But we cannot reject it. We don't have a separate will. We do not have a separate will. There is no separate will. All is God's will, actually. There is no separate will. So if we can't create a separate will, what good is all this time for? That's what time was made for. That's what we made it for. Because if you can't do something and you desire to do it, what else can you do except to imagine time? What else can you do? And you say, I'm working on it. I have all this time. Look all this time I got. Wow. Where did that appear from? Magic. Oh my gosh, I've got so much time. And over the scope of this time, I'll be working on this issue. So I can't really assess whether it's possible or not at this point because, you know, all this time has to pass and I have to see how it, you know, goes over all this time. This is all our imagination. This is all a automatic reaction to us desiring to have a separate will. Is suddenly, boom, time, space appears. Big bang, boom. It's automatic. That's the Big Bang. It's automatic. You have to have time and space to entertain this idea at all because it's impossible. then how can the impossible seem possible? Because suddenly you have all this time and space to work on it. To spend time. I'm learning. All this time to learn. And locations to arrange. Space to rearrange everything in. Say, okay, endless rearrangements. What else can you do but have fragments and rearrange? Time to rearrange fragments. When you desire to accomplish the impossible, suddenly there's time and fragments, and you have all the time to rearrange these fragments. You see, I'm putting it all together. You have to have all these fragments. I'm putting it all together. I'm working to put this puzzle of a separate will together. I've got all these pieces. All I need to do is put them together. But that might take a long, long time. But look, I got plenty of time to work on this. This is the delusion. This is the whim. This is the projection. This is the imagination of spirit. Of course, if you give up trying to do the impossible, what do you need time for? What do you need time and space for? What do you need fragments for? You don't need time, space, and fragments. Not ultimately. We have a continuity fear, so we'll maintain familiar surroundings. That's fine. So that's how time and space and fragments came into appearance, arose as an appearance. There's nowhere else to go with this idea of creating a separate will. There's nowhere else to go. It's impossible right now. So we invent time and space and fragments. It's all just a projection. Now, when you realize what we've done, we say, oh, I don't really need time, but God has given us this gift of holiness. So we're able to see the holiness of time. Now time and space and fragmentation all appears holy because it has a new purpose just to remind us of reality. Its other purpose it cannot serve, actually. All of this stuff in the world is actually not serving any purpose at this moment. Not serving any purpose. Because how can you serve the purpose of impossibility? How can that be served? Is there someone to serve? Serve something that to serve? No. So the highest confession is, I have no choice. Nobody has any choice. And therein lies the freedom, right, from time, that nobody has any choice. We all have the gift of God's holiness, God's gift of holiness. We all have it. Can't get rid of it, can't reject it, can't get rid of it. It's within us already. It's a done deal. No choice. The gifts of God are mine. God's gift of holiness is mine. I don't have a separate will to accept or reject it. I have no choice. What God has given to me is mine. What God has given to me is mine. It's total arrogance to think otherwise. So it's not the holy that are arrogant, not the ones who are having this holy vision of oneness. This holy instant. They're not arrogant. It's the ones who claim that they cannot have that are being arrogant. Because they're saying, well, I can reject that if I want to. I can reject that. No, we cannot. We don't have a separate will. Our will is one with God. So what God wills for us is for us. There's nothing that can stand in its way and block it. There's nothing that can get rid of it. It's with. So what's the most important, highest confession? I have no choice. God's gift of holiness is mine. I have no separate will to block this. And therefore, it's mine right now. It'll always be mine. What do I need all this time for? To recognize it. Why? Time is to try and develop a separate will in order to deny this. So it will dawn, the realizations will dawn when you make this confession. What I found was, you just suddenly say, ah, I see that. It's so very clear, it's hard to explain it. But obviously, you see just the obviousness of it, say, okay, very great. It's not something we have to earn, God's gift of holiness. We already have it. We just need to realize that we don't have any choice about it, which means we don't have a separate will. So as long as we're trying to produce a separate will, we will insist that we have a choice in the matter, and then try to choose it, actually. God's already chosen it for us. We don't have any choice in this situation. If we tried to prank ourselves, tried to believe that we could sell ourselves, tried to believe we could separate ourselves from reality, hold ourselves hostage, sell reality, we tried to run this prank on ourselves out of just, maybe we were like adolescents or juveniles who just felt like they wanted to do something really crazy just for the heck of it. So all of this is simply a prank. All this time and space that arises out of our desire to accomplish the impossible, which immediately sets up a workshop. What else can you do to set up a workshop? So you can say, well, yeah, I can't do it right now, but look at all this time. It happens in time, we say. It doesn't happen in the now, it happens in time. It doesn't happen with the wholeness, it happens with fragments. See, it doesn't happen in the zero dimensionality of pure spaciousness. It happens in space. The space around objects. It happens there. And we just have to learn to appreciate it. Maybe we say it's already happened. This is it. We just have to learn to appreciate it. Time and space and fragmentation. So a workshop arises. We're in the workshop. Workshop arises when we have this crazy, whimsical desire. But we can use to give a different purpose for the workshop, and that is just simple beauty. Just the whole thing is no longer we're trying to learn to love, value, and appreciate death. We just simply see everything in the workshop as equally beautiful. And then what do we need to do with the workshop? Whether we do something or not, it's all the same. Generally speaking, we just let everything be. It's kind of like we have a flower arrangement, and we decide, you know what, it's so beautiful, but I'm going to take this flower, I'm going to move this one over here, and I'm going to shift this one over there, and you look at it and say, ah, yeah. That's really beautiful too. Now, okay, wait a minute, let me move this one in front and put this one in the back and this one to that side and shift it a little bit there. Ah, that too is totally beautiful. And then at some point you realize, you know what? However I rearrange it, it's all the same beauty. It's all the same timelessness. It's all the same vision of holy oneness. So then you tend to just say, well, just let everything just be exactly as it is. There's no worry. So you tend to not be like a world changer, someone who wants to change the world. Someone wants to rearrange everything. Now, holiness is holiness. Holiness is one. The world seen as one. So the holiness is everywhere. There's nowhere to go where it's not. So as we get to the April 15th, I'm certainly feeling the stress. Those I know are feeling the stress. There's some people right now who are in very, very, very critical condition, actually, unfortunately. So it's incumbent upon me to stop delaying. And the way to do that is to remain in the mood of repentance. Remain in the mood of repentance. Not in a trance like this, not zoned out, but alert, calm, optimistic, confident, serious, sober, with a touch of good humor to the whole thing, of course. You're not in an angry mood. I saw a motorcycle rider on their chopper with their gang jacket on, you know, motorcycle gang jacket on. And the back of the jacket said, Mr. Hateful, with a skull, evil-looking skull with some kind of helmet or something, blood-red helmet, you know. Well, there's the blood moon right there, actually. Yeah. Wow. I hadn't thought of that. Mr. Hateful Skull. Here it comes. The world is full of hate, so how do we help the world full of good humor? How can we be full of good humor seeing the vision of holy oneness, actually? Because then you have very good humor, actually. You're always blissful, overflowing with bliss. And that is what's required starting April 15th here in this world. So I'm trying to push myself there, and regretfully, I'm so slow. There's no real reason not to, you know, because we have no choice in the matter. So if we have no choice, why are we pretending that we do? It's just stupid. It's just completely stupid. So I think I just have to adjust to that and get some humor about it. Why are we pretending we have a choice when we don't? See, that's the question. And when the jig's up, you see, I really don't have any choice. Then it's just, you're in a state of stupidity. You realize your stupidity. It's like, that's when you have to have some forgiveness and patience with yourself. That's why I say the vision, the mood of repentance is so important to everyone. Because we have to have some forgiveness and patience with ourselves. Otherwise, we're going to get very angry at ourselves for being so stupid. And we think, well, our good humor might run out. Everyone will come to us for good humor and it's going to run out. Maybe that's the fear, underlying fear. Probably it is. Yeah. Because for sure, you know, when it's coming up in the world, people are going to be in hateful moods. And people will be desperate for, you know, they say, I don't want to go into that, but Where is the humor? I don't see it. You know, where is the goodness? I don't see it. What's happened to the world? I don't see it. You know, wow, what's happened? All the hate suddenly. And then somebody is just in like this, just overflowing with good humor, bliss, overflowing with bliss. They say, wow, you know, I want that. And so people will just like latch on, and you wonder like, oh my gosh, maybe it's too much, and I'll snap, and I'll go back to being Mr. Hateful. And so that, maybe that's the question, like in my mind, I'm thinking like, can it be sustained? Well, we got no choice because God put it there. See, the problem is we think we put it there, so we're concerned about sustaining it. We didn't put it there. We didn't put the gift of holiness there. God put the gift of holiness there. Holiness meaning to resolve the continuity problem, the vision of holiness. We see all time, space, and things, fragments, as one holiness, one complete holiness without a second. See, we didn't put that there. So as long as we think that our will had something to do with it, we're going to be scared about running out of gas. And then so we're going to delay. So we have to keep on reminding ourselves about will. It's so important. We don't have a separate will. There is no separate will. There's only God's will. We don't have some will separate from God. We are trying to learn how to, but we haven't learned anything. And we're just studying fragments. As if that had some relevance. What else can we do when we're trying to accomplish the impossible? Except have all this time, space, and fragments, and then spend our time studying these fragments and rearranging them and thinking that, we're learning a lot here. Really learning a lot. Yeah, so the fear is that it won't stay. It won't stay with you. But we have no choice. It has to stay with us. Now, when that will dawn upon me, I don't know. But when you get to this point, you know that you've got a very bright future. You have a very bright future. When you can celebrate the fact that you don't have any choice and you realize, wow, that's the key. I don't have any choice. When you can let that sink in, really let it sink in, I don't have any choice. I have to be holy. Everyone has to be holy. There isn't any choice to it whatsoever. Those pretending they have a choice are just joking themselves, just telling a funny joke. And you just have to laugh at the funny joke. So, holiness here in time space, holiness is our real condition, is our actual condition. It's what enables us to set time, space, and fragments down. So again, everyone has no choice in this, except they have to accept their holiness. So if that's the case, why not do it now? So I'm a little bit dumb about this at this point. Kind of the wheels are spinning, I'm trying to say, like, yeah, that makes sense. I see that. Is there something else to see? Is there anything else to see? Yeah, look around. Maybe there's nothing else to see. That's it. I have no choice. If I have no choice, why am I looking around for a choice? Maybe there's a choice there. Maybe there's a choice there. No, there is no choice. There's no choice here. There's no choice there. There's no choice inside, there's no choice outside. So this, I don't have any choice, is incredibly important and helpful to get on the good side of that and celebrate and say, yes, that's wonderful. That means I can't lose it. Cannot lose it. Only when I'm looking for a different source of it, does it seem to disappear, right? You're looking for a different source. Well, you want to claim it, though. Another will, you know, put that there, not God or something. So, okay. I'll see if I can do some exercises to help out with this. 15th is coming up. What, 3 days away? 3 days away. And look at the world. Look at the world. Look at the symbology that's at play in the world right now. And again, Mr. Hateful is going to come out. And of course, Mr. Hateful actually hates the belief that there is a separate will, that there is a choice. See, there's a funny thing. They feel like, I have to make this choice. You know, it's an incredibly difficult choice, you know. And I can either choose holiness or not choose it. And I just don't know which, you know, I'm trying to figure this out. And they hate this, thinking that they have can choose between two wills. They're thinking it's too difficult a decision. They hate this decision. There is no decision. There is no decision to make. There is no choice to make. What God wills for us is ours. There's no choice to it. So when you realize there's no choice to it, you stop being Mr. Hateful. Because you don't have to make any choice. It's more of a realization that you don't have to make a choice. You can say, I can choose to give up, you know, trying to say that I have a choice, believe that I have a choice. Yeah, we can say that. We can say that I choose to accept that I don't have a choice. That's fine. Use of language. I can choose to accept that I don't have a choice. Saves time. All that choice does in this world is saves time. The meaningless, aimlessness of time. It just means, hey, I don't need time as time. I can see time as holiness. So I don't need time as time. I can see time as holiness now. As the holy instant, as Jesus puts it. I can see time as holy. I don't have to see it as time. Time as time. I can see time as holiness or time as time. Time working on this decision I'm trying to make. Which will do I go with? When you realize there's only one will, then you don't need the time. And then you can see all time as the same. See as holy. It stops, full stop. End of time is when you realize you don't need time. You don't need time as time. Now, this may seem, all this talk may seem very abstract or something, but I'm telling you, Mr. Hateful is getting ready to ride. Yeah, Mr. Hateful's getting ready to ride with the blood moon coming up. Time of action. What did the great POTUS say? This year's going to be a year of action. Now, it's very important to realize that the third dimension is imploding, being brought down. Fourth dimension is like a dimension of action, in a certain sense, that it's like getting down to brass tacks as far as teaching how to love, value, and appreciate death. They're saying, okay, no more talking about it. Now we're going to do it. That's the fourth dimension. Third dimension is a lot of talk. So, you know, a lot of talk doesn't really work anymore. Practice is what works. Practice is the fifth dimensional spiritual effort to acceptance, to go towards acceptance that we don't have any choice. Acceptance that we don't have any choice. The gifts of God are ours. They're given to us by God. We don't have any choice in the matter. That's fifth dimensional, right spiritual practice, which is doing these affirmations. It's really not dialogue, it's not thinking, it's not conceptualized, it's not trying. That's third dimensional stuff. So third dimensional stuff doesn't work anymore because the fourth dimensionals are saying, time, you know, the recess is over, kiddies. It's time now to get back to class and to focus in on really learning, you know. You really got to learn how to, they say, value, appreciate, and love death. And you got to be fast-tracked. So fourth dimension is the fast-track. Fifth dimension is holiness. Realizing we have no choice. We are holy. We have been given the gift of holiness, meaning within time. Holiness relates to time. Reality doesn't need any terms to describe it. The holy vision, the holy instant, Jesus calls it, the holy instant. Very good term. It seems so abstract, but we're closing in on it. It really is what it is. So see if you can't do the fifth dimensional right spiritual practices. The exercise, the practice videos are that fifth dimensional right spiritual practice. And then that leads to you realizing, hey, I don't have any choice. What God's the gifts that God has given me are mine. Don't have any choice in that matter at all. They're mine. I cannot get rid of them. They're with me. They stay with me. They are mine. Might as well accept it. Accept this fact. I don't have any choice. I don't have any choice in the matter. Okay, very great. This is a huge leap forward, and we need huge leaps forward into true fifth dimensional awareness and functioning, of which functioning in awareness of holiness, the holy vision of oneness. That's where we need to be. We need to be centered in that going forward. And of course, the hatefulness is about ready to make its appearance in the world. It's about ready to ride. You know, it's about ready to ride. Mr. Hateful is about ready to ride. It's going to probably start riding with the first blood moon. It'll be no surprise. So we need this overflowing bliss, okay? We need overflowing bliss. And that's right within our awareness now. It's right there. Right there. Very easy get now. Very easy. So we will get it. All right. That's it for this video.